Well, good afternoon and welcome to the Water Research Foundation webcast on the project titled Optimization of Energy and Water Quality Management Systems for Drinking Water Utilities. This project was co-funded by the Water Research Foundation and the California Energy Commission. My name is Linda Rieke and I'm a research manager at the Water Research Foundation. I will be moderating today's webcast. The foundation has been funding research related to energy and water quality management systems since 1995. The first project we funded was a partnership project with the Electric Power Research Institute and several water utilities to investigate incorporating an energy management system with a water utility SCADA system. Since that first project, the foundation has funded five projects, including this one, related to implementing energy and water quality management systems. The focus of the research project that will be presented today was to investigate the use of an energy and water quality management system for either energy cost reduction, energy consumption reduction, or greenhouse gas emission reduction, and to evaluate the trade-offs when using the energy water quality management system to optimize for any one of these. This webcast will be 60 minutes with 50 minutes of presentation and 10 minutes of Q&A at the end of the presentation. If you have questions during the presentation, please type them into the question box at the bottom right corner of your screen. And if we're unable to answer all the questions today, we will post written answers to the questions on the Foundation Project 4271 webpage. If you have colleagues that want to view this webcast but are not available today, the webcast will be available to view on demand on the Foundation Project 4271 webpage by the end of the day tomorrow. At the end of today's webcast, there will be a short participant survey, and I encourage you to please take a minute to complete it. Now, I'm pleased to introduce the presenters for today's webcast. Dr. Mohammed Badruzaman was the principal investigator for the project. He is a registered professional civil engineer in California with 15 years of applied research experience in environmental engineering. As a supervising engineer at MWH Global, his research focus centers at the interface of several disciplines, including water treatment, water reuse, desalination, energy management, and sustainable water management. He received his MS and PhD degrees in environmental engineering from Arizona State University. He has authored more than 50 peer-reviewed and conference papers on the technical and economic evaluation of treatment technologies and environmental issues. Also presenting, Simon Bunn graduated with a Bachelor of Engineering electrical degree and for 21 years gained experience in control system design before becoming a partner in the Becca Group in 1999. In 2000, Simon used his experience of control systems and water treatment processes to design the software at the heart of the AquaAdapt product, the world's first commercially available real-time water operations optimizer. The AquaAdapt software for Wellington City was judged the top engineering project in New Zealand in 2002. In 2005, Simon was named the Engineering Entrepreneur of the Year at the New Zealand Engineering Excellence Awards. So with that, I believe I'd like to turn it over to Mohammed. Welcome, Mohammed.
Thanks, Linda, and thanks everyone for dialing in for this webcast. First of all, I would like to acknowledge funding agencies, Water Research Foundation and California Energy Commission for providing the funding for this work. And also, project managers and the project team and advisory committee of the project for their valuable inputs throughout this study. Excuse me. We had 18 utilities participating in this study. I would like to acknowledge contribution from two utilities, East Bay Municipal Utility District and also Eastern Municipal Water District. They provided us the pilot site for the study. They provided us access to the data. Also, during the pilot study, they collected water quality samples for this project. So we are thankful to the entire team of East Bay MUD and Eastern Municipal Water District. In terms of the agenda of this webcast, we'll start with a little bit of background, then we'll talk about where we are in terms of EWQMS implementation, and what were the objectives of this project, and what research approach we used to accomplish those objectives. We'll talk about the results we obtained from the pilot studies, and a little bit on the cost-benefit analysis of an EWQMS, and what sort of implementation challenges that utilities encountered when implementing EWQMS, and we'll end up with a brief set of conclusions. Now, EWQMS, which is Energy and Water Quality Management System, sometimes people call it EQUAM, as Linda mentioned, that the concept originated in early 90s. The idea behind this framework was to minimize energy costs and meet water quality goals at the same time within a utility's operational constraints. You can use different kinds of strategies to minimize energy costs. One of the limitations of the existing framework is that it does not account or optimize for energy efficiency or greenhouse gas reduction. As you know, that more and more utilities are looking for options to minimize greenhouse gas emission. When it comes to drinking water utility, we know that as high as 90% of greenhouse gas emission could be due to electricity use, which is due to the pumping. So there is a driver to go back to this EWQMS framework and see what this framework can be done or how we can modify this framework to emphasize on greenhouse gas emission reduction. The idea was that if we can do that, then that will allow water utilities to look for alternatives that will allow them to identify more energy efficient alternatives, also that will identify more sustainable operational strategies. Now, a little bit of historical information about the developer of EWQMS, and Linda already mentioned that the idea was developed in early 90s. And first few years, most effort were to identify some of the elements of EWQMS and the specifications of EWQMS. There are a couple of utilities, and we need to acknowledge them, JEA and Colorado Springs. They are the utilities who initially pilot tested EWQMS concept. And then later on in 2004, East Bay Mud actually installed a commercial grade EWQMS. And since then, the number of other utilities started to install EWQMS. To date, we have more than 20 utilities are under EWQMS operation. Most of them use this commercial grade product from Derceto. There are other utilities who actually develop their own optimizer. For example, Las Vegas Valley Water District, Metro Vancouver, and also Yorkshire Water, they have them develop their own optimizer and implemented entire framework of EWQMS or some part of EWQMS. Going to the next slide, what actually this EWQMS framework is. For a water utility perspective, they have to collect water, treat water, store water, and distribute water. So the operations planner and a scheduler, they actually develop the daily operating plan for the entire operation. Now, this is the usual operation of a water utility. If you include electric cost tariff in that decision-making, that operating planner, then the whole framework becomes EWQMS, which means you do exactly the same thing you have been doing. Now the focus is to do the same thing at a minimum energy cost. I'm not going to go through the detail of the EWQMS framework. We just published a paper in the Journal of Environmental Management that details some of the things that has been in the peer-reviewed last decade or so. Now let's look at the optimization principle of an EWQMS. If you look at the center of the circle, which is the objective function, is energy cost reduction. That's the traditional optimization principle, and you need to do that within the operating constraints related to water quality, system equilibrium, from hydraulic point of view also, asset management, and the permits and regulations from the supply side also in the distribution side. Then, to minimize energy cost, we'll have to focus on energy charges and energy efficiency. Looking at the energy charges, we'll have to deal with the tariff rate. It could be flat or it could be time of use tariff structure. So we'll have to find a way to pump water at the cheapest tariff period. That would be the goal of this strategy. The other aspect of it is to minimize demand charge. And as you know, the demand charge could be a substantial cost of the monthly energy bill. Then the other aspect of it is you need to operate pump as energy efficiently as possible. There are a number of ways to do that. So in this traditional approach of EWQMS, the focus is mainly on to reduce energy charges and to make the system more energy efficient. Now, let's review what are the current status of EWQMS implementation. To do that, we interviewed 5 utilities, we spoke with them, and we tried to understand what the current practices they have in terms of EWQMS. The few things we wanted to look at, we wanted to interview utilities that are using commercial product. We also wanted to learn from the utilities they use in-house developed optimizer. For example, Las Vegas Valley Water District. We also have a utility outside of US just to get an idea of how they're implementing EWQMS at their operation. As you can see, these are the 5 utilities who participated in this case studies. Just one point I wanted to highlight here, if you look at the percent of entire system, for some of the utilities, they have 100% of their asset under EWQMS operation, and some of the utilities, they have fraction of their asset under EWQMS operation. But all of these utilities actually implemented EWQMS on a phase-by-phase basis. They started with the area that is more equipped for EWQMS implementation. At the same time, the benefit from implementing EWQMS was the highest. So they learned from it and then they expanded for the other regions. Now, what do we need to implement an EWQMS? And of course, you need an optimizer that's going to produce the solution for you. And you need a hydraulic model that's going to validate that whatever solution this optimizer produces is meeting the hydraulic requirement. You need an up-to-date SCADA system, which can control the pumps, also can store the data every 10 minutes or so. And you also need some of the hardware that can allow you to communicate with the remote pump stations from the central location. You need flow meter and you need the remote control equipment. The last item you need is the demand forecaster. You need to know what would be the demand in next 12 hours or 24 hours or even 48 hours to implement EWQMS. Now let's look at some of the cost savings these utilities received through implementing EWQMS. The energy bill, annual energy bill for these utilities varies from close to $2 million to $20 million. If you look at the percent energy cost saving numbers, they're able to save energy from energy costs from 8% to as high as 23%. If you look at the energy savings numbers, they were able to save energy from 6% to 13%. Now, one particular point I wanted to highlight is this energy savings came from just making the changes in operation without investing in the asset or the pump, So just by changing the operation, you can receive a substantial amount of energy savings. Now let's look at what was the project cost of these EWQMS implementations. As you can see, that it varied from $750,000 to close to $4 million. Now what does this cost include? These are if they're using commercial optimizer, then the cost associated with the software, and also implement and configure the software according to their need and bring all their asset under EWQMS operation. Also the personal training for the people involved in EWQMS projects. This does not include the costs related to the SCADA and hardware because these utilities already had the new generation of SCADA that supports EWQMS implementation. Now if you look at the payback period was from 2 years to 5 years. So that's an attractive payback period period for these utilities. So the EWQMS has been doing what it's supposed to do, is to reduce energy costs. The question is why we needed this project. You know, if you look at the energy consumption reduction, then we have to focus solely on energy efficiency. We no longer can focus on energy charges. Now, if we focus on energy greenhouse gas reduction, then we'll have to focus on energy efficiency, at the same time energy source, natural gas versus grid electricity, or even for grid electricity, what is the source of that grid electricity? So from a comprehensive point of view, if you look at the objective function now, it could be either cost or energy or greenhouse gas reduction, which means that we'll have to deal with energy charges, energy efficiency, and energy source. So our goal was to see if we update this EWQMS framework, what are the consequences of that? So the questions that we are trying to answer were, how does the EWQMS work if greenhouse gas reduction is a driver? The second question was, well, what happens to water quality if the EWQMS operation is based on the lowest greenhouse gas operation? And the third question was, does lower greenhouse gas operation result in increased operating costs for water utilities? So we try to address these questions, and throughout this presentation, we'll try to answer these questions. So the research approach we used is we had to conduct this research in three phases. First, we had to modify this existing EWQMS, and we created a greenhouse gas module. Then we tested that module offline, tried to understand that what sort of results we're going to get if we tested it on a real-time basis. Then we went to two utilities, and we tested them on a real-time basis. Just briefly, the conceptual optimization framework, the way it works is we have pump efficiency curve and all the information related to the pump, all the information related to the tariff, and historical hydraulic data, and all the system constraints. So demand forecaster forecasts the demand, and all this information goes to the optimizer. It initially creates a set of schedule for the pumps. Then that schedule is validated by the hydraulic model just to make sure that all the schedule is meeting the hydraulic requirement. And then the final schedule E for the pumping is developed. Here's the screenshot of the greenhouse gas module, or the modified EWQMS we developed for this project. The way we worked on this is we optimized one pump station at a time. Once the pump station is optimized, then the data is used to optimize the next pump station. So that's how we optimize the entire pilot area, and Simon is going to talk about that in detail in a few slides. So let's just review what are the optimization goals we had. When we say cost optimization, the primary principle behind that cost optimization is the pump will have to be operated at the minimum cost possible. And the secondary principle was the pump will be operated at the lowest specific energy. Now, when you get into the kilowatt hour optimization, the primary principle was pump will be operated at the lowest energy, specific energy. And the tariff will be completely ignored. It will be the flat tariff operation. And the third one was greenhouse gas optimization, which means that the pump will be operated when greenhouse gas emission factor is minimum. And Simon is going to talk about that in detail. All of these scenarios we compare with the baseline, which is baseline means the no optimization software. It was just operated manually by the operators based on their judgment. So with that, I'll hand it over to Simon, who's going to walk us through the results that we obtained from two pilot studies of this project. Simon?
Thanks very much, Mohammed. So I'm going to walk you through what we did in the offline and real-time trials and the results we came up with. Now, to do real-time trials, we really had to use sites that were already using an EWQMS system. And the two we chose were East Bay Mud and EMWD, both in California. There are quite some differences between the two utilities, and one of the key differences you'll see here is that EMWD, we're using a mix of electric and natural gas driven pumps, and that had to be taken into account when we're doing the optimization. There's also obviously a mix of tariffs. East Bay Mud are on the PG&E supply, and EMWD are on Southern California Edison. So it gave us a reasonable range of operation to do the trials. So starting with EMWD, the little diagram we have on the screen is actually just a very small subset of their system, and the only key information to take out of this is that what we wanted to do was choose an area that could be reasonably isolated from everywhere else. So we wanted to make sure that we could run it and it would have no impact on the rest of the system, and also there would be no inflows or outflows out of the pilot area. And in the case of EMWD, we chose the Mission Canyon Valley. The three pump stations in Mission Canyon Valley are actually all on different tariffs. So the super peak tariff, which is the one in green, has very high on-peak charges, but only over a very short four-hour window, whereas there was a flat tariff, as you can see, at Mission Canyon 1. And where most energy companies offer a range of tariffs, it's sometimes worthwhile figuring out which tariff is the most beneficial at which pump station. And that was part of this strategy we were also going to look at. What we wanted to do is also take into account greenhouse gas. Now, one of the interesting things is when you're trying to optimize for greenhouse gas reduction, if you talk to the energy supplier, like PG&E or SCE, they'll give you a single fixed number for the number of tons of CO2 per megawatt hour of energy. And that really is their annual average number. That wouldn't be that useful for us in the optimization strategy, because if you have a single flat number of tons of CO2 per megawatt hour, that then effectively means that all you're really trying to do is minimize kilowatt hours. It's exactly the same optimization. Well, we're already doing a kilowatt hour optimization, so we decided what we really needed to do is figure out whether that was true. There's a very complex model of the California market, energy market, called the Plexos model, and that model's includes the CO2 per megawatt hour for the entire range of production across the market, and also market demand. So on the top right of the screen, you'll see a plot which shows the CO2 per megawatt hour of production as the market demand increases. So we're starting at sort of 20 gigawatts right through to 50 or 60 gigawatts in the market. And the strategy we came up with was saying that if we avoided a megawatt hour of energy consumption, it was at the margin, i.e. it was the last megawatt hour that entered the market. And if that slope, as you see, is going up, it means that there is more benefit to avoid energy consumption at times when the market was under stress, which makes sense. Unfortunately, it's not the way that PG&E and SCE record and monitor their consumption. By doing this, there's another little benefit, and that is that obviously as the market demand goes up, the price goes up, which is the blue on this graph. And as the price goes up, we also note there's an alignment with the number of pounds of CO2 per megawatt hour, kind of aligns with the energy tariff. And that makes sense. Obviously, as the demand in the market goes up, more generators come in, more expensive generators come into the market. That's why the price goes up. And also those more expensive generators tend to be the least efficient. They are producing more greenhouse gas per megawatt hour. So this alignment is important, and I'll explain what's important later on. The second thing we mentioned was that EMWD used gas pumps. And in the past, gas pumps were preferred over electric pumps because they were considered to be substantially cheaper to operate. And if you look at the data in the columns for year 2010, that was definitely true. The bottom row shows that the gas pumps were delivering water for about $52 per million gallons versus $122 for the electric pumps. But as you're well aware, fracking's changed the market in the states. It has reduced gas prices, of course, but it has also reduced energy costs, electricity production costs, quite substantially. So the tariffs of the market changed, and in 2013, it turned out the situation has inverted. The gas pumps have not really changed in their price, but the electric pumps have become substantially cheaper. If you also look at the greenhouse gas emissions in pounds per million gallons delivered, the gas pumps are about four times the CO2 released per million gallons pumped than the electric pumps. That's taking into account all the factors. That, therefore, obviously would mean that not only would you save money by using electric pumps, you would save a substantial amount of greenhouse gas emissions. So what we did is we ran some trials of EMWD, and then we ran some online results. And these graphs just show two of the main two pump stations, Diamond 3 and Mission Canyon 2. Now, under the baseline operation, you can see that the operation was using no peak energy, which is not surprising. The pumps only need to run about 6 to 8 hours per day, and they could easily avoid that super peak period of 4 hours. They were using a substantial amount of off-peak power and some super off-peak power, which is the nighttime and weekend rates. Under cost optimization, you can see a greater percentage of the super off-peak tariff has been used. But when we go to kilowatt-hour optimization and greenhouse gas optimization, it's now ignoring tariff completely. And because it's ignoring the tariff, it is actually just choosing to pump when it sees that the kilowatt-hours generated by the pump is the lowest. Now, Mohammed mentioned that there's an embedded hydraulic model. So what the optimization is doing is it's looking at how the pumps are operating on their pump curve, how they operate together in a chain of pumps to try and use the lowest specific energy, the lowest kilowatt hours per million gallon delivered. By ignoring the tariff, they are actually saving energy, but they are pushing up the consumption of energy in the more expensive periods. And it was just by sheer coincidence that it did not choose to pump in the 4 hour peak period on these trials we ran. You can see at Mission Canyon 3, though, it did run during that super peak period. You can see the little bit of green at the bottom, that is the expensive energy. Now, that energy can be 8 times the price of off-peak energy, so it can have a significant cost impact. But remember, tariff was ignored for both the kilowatt-hour optimization and the greenhouse gas optimization. So what impact did this actually have on price? Well, you can see the baseline cost shown in the first column. When we go into cost optimization, there is definitely cost reduction, as would be expected, in both demand charges and electricity charges. But remember that kilowatt-hour optimization was using more of the super peak tariff, and so you can see the cost has actually gone up under kilowatt-hour optimization. Greenhouse gas optimization also ignored tariff, and it was also slightly more expensive. The blue graph at the bottom right corner gives an indication of the kilowatt-hours that were consumed. And what's interesting is when we run EWQMS, it, regardless of whether you're chasing cost, kilowatt-hours or greenhouse gas, the best strategy tends to be to run efficiently. And so all three of them are showing quite significant improvements in the specific energy. They have reduced the kilowatt hours per energy delivered quite significantly. What does that actually mean when we compared the trials for online and offline? Is that we can see that in the first columns under cost reduction, we were expecting in the offline simulations to actually almost double the 194% increase in cost. When we actually ran the system online on the pilot, it was actually more aligned to the tariff, and it actually only had a small increase in cost by running the system online. So the first columns in each of those rows is the offline simulation prediction, and the second column, is the what actually happened when we trialed it online. The other interesting thing to pick up from this is that regardless of whether we're chasing energy, greenhouse gas, or cost, the actual kilowatt hour consumption basically reduced about the same amount in all three trials, at 2.8% to 2.9%. So they were all achieving roughly the same results in terms of greenhouse gas reduction and in kilowatt hour reduction, even though cost reduction in the first row was the important target. And that's quite an important concept, because one of the outcomes we were trying to determine from this trial was if we chased just greenhouse gas reduction, what would be the cost of that? I mean, how much extra would it cost us, and how much extra benefit would we get from greenhouse gas reduction? And what we've seen here is that chasing cost had almost exactly the same benefit in terms of greenhouse gas reduction as just purely focusing on greenhouse gas. So then we're looking at the second trial area, which is East Bay Mud. Now, this is a more interesting area and has some differences from the previous system we looked at. The previous system was a cascade chain, that is, there are three pump stations in series. In this scenario, we actually have two pump stations in parallel, Black Hawk and Black Hawk East, which both draw from basically the same elevation levels from their downstream tanks, which is Scenic and Scenic East. And they both deliver into the same area, the Black Hawk area, which has two floating balance tanks in the Black Hawk area, and also primes the suction side of the Acorn pumping system, which delivers into its own tanks, the Acorn tank. So this is going to have different characteristics than EMWD. Again, we've got these sort of tariffs you'd expect with a peak period. Now, what is interesting is that East Bay Mud is one of the original proponents of EWQMS, had already done a substantial amount of energy management, and as part of that, they had instigated a lockout on the pumps during that peak period from 12 midday to 6 p.m. All pump stations are locked out. No pumps can run. And they have enough storage to make that quite possible without actually any implications for customers in terms of pressure and water supply. Again, when we did the offline simulation, we ignored tariff, and we indicated that, as you can see with the cost optimization, the EWQMS is using substantially more off-peak energy and less shoulder energy than the manual operation. You see the manual operation did actually use a small amount of peak power, so even though they were locked out, we did find that actually occasionally the pumps were manually running the peak periods. But as soon as you go to kilowatt hour optimization or greenhouse gas optimization and you ignore tariff in the offline trials, it does want to run pumps during those 6-hour periods and will actually use that energy, which is quite expensive. We see the same information at the Acorn pump station. So we would expect that to have quite an impact on cost. When we ran the real-time operation, though, we see quite a different pattern, and that is because of that lockout. So in the real-time operation, we had seen very little of any peak period operation, the green band at the bottom of the bars. But we are seeing that under cost optimization, we are increasing the amount of off-peak power being used versus the mid-peak, which has a cost savings. But under kilowatt-hour optimization and greenhouse gas optimization, because it's ignoring the tariff, what tends to happen is pumping is spread more across the day, and that makes sense. If you think of it, if you're running, say, 2 or 3 pumps at a high flow rate to fill a tank, you tend to have more back pressure, there's more kilowatt hours per energy delivered, and therefore the efficiency drops. But if you actually ran one pump steadily throughout the day, you have less back pressure, you'll use less specific energy, and therefore spreading pumping across the day tends to be a better strategy in terms of greenhouse gas and kilowatt hours. What impact does that actually have on the costs? We, as you see from the graph, the baseline operation has been tracked for many years, and then under cost optimization, there's quite a substantial saving, mainly in demand charges. And that is that the demand charges are actually applied over a wider period of time than the peak tariff charges. And because of that, even a small transgression of running 2 pumps or 3 pumps during a peak demand window can have quite a significant cost impact, which is pretty much hidden to the operators. So, but under EWQMS, it did take that into account and therefore reduce demand charges. You also note there's actually not a lot of difference between cost optimization, kilowatt optimization, greenhouse gas optimization under real time. And that's probably because they were locked out from operating during that peak period. In terms of kilowatt hours per energy delivered, there's quite a substantial improvement under all three optimization strategies, and there's very little difference between them. So cost optimization actually and kilowatt hour optimization made very little difference as to what was targeted. Quite an important concept because it does mean that if you are chasing cost optimization, you are not really paying much penalty in terms of could I do better in terms of kilowatt hour consumption or could I do better in terms of greenhouse gas consumption. You can see here there's almost nothing in it. Cost optimization alone will actually achieve the outcomes of reducing greenhouse gas. So if we compare that offline and online trial, now you're seeing some reasonably substantial differences between the offline simulations, which was allowed to pump at any time of the day, versus the pilot trials when we were locked out during that 6-hour window. If you look at the first row of cost optimization, you can see that in fact the offline simulation and the pilot trials were almost identical with that 23% savings that Mohammed mentioned earlier in the presentation. Energy reduction, we expected to actually use slightly more energy, because it was chasing cost and was therefore willing to sacrifice efficiency to chase cost in the off-peak periods. But in fact, in real application, we actually saw an improvement in energy efficiency of 4.8%. And when chasing purely greenhouse gas and not trying to achieve anything else, we achieved the same 4.8%. Kilowatt hour optimization, slight improvement in reduction in kilowatt hours to 5.3%. And at greenhouse gas optimization, this is where, again, we're using that Plexos model, not a flat greenhouse gas tariff, it is actually still trying to reduce consumption during the peak periods of the day, because that's when it thinks the greenhouse gas component is the highest. So that kind of explains why under greenhouse gas optimization, we actually use slightly more kilowatt hours than under kilowatt hour optimization. One question that was asked by East Bay Mud was that one of the strategies that EWQMS uses is to try and run the most efficient pump at the most efficient time of the day to achieve improvements in the specific energy. And the question that East Bay Mud asked us was, rather than run a rotation policy, what would be the benefit if they effectively locked in the most efficient pump at each pump station as the primary duty pump, the second most efficient pump as the standby pump, and so on? And by locking that in, they were hoping to achieve similar kilowatt hour savings. So we ran a series of trials over 6 weeks. For the first week, we ran just all pump one at all stations. Second 2 weeks, all pump two. Third 2 weeks, all pump three, and so on. Having then determined which was the most efficient pump, for weeks 5 and 6, we actually ran the most efficient pump combination of each pump station. And then obviously we compared that with what EWQMS was achieving. And these are the results. So under a manual pump rotation strategy, which most utilities use, which is to even out the run hours, you can see that the specific energy was running around just short of 26,000 kilowatt hours. Under running the manual operation using the most efficient pump, there was a small improvement. It was about 1.4% improvement just by locking in the most efficient pump. So beneficial, but not what we would have expected to achieve. And under EWQMS operation, there was actually a 5.8% improvement in energy efficiency. Those are the figures you saw from the graph before. Now, the reason that EWQMS is getting much more efficiency than just choosing the most efficient pump is that it's not only choosing which pump to run, it's choosing when to run it and when to run pumps at the same time. If you think of that layout of Black Hawk and Black Hawk East in parallel, and then you've got Acorn off to the side in the same pressure zone that they're delivering into, if you run Black Hawk or Black Hawk East pump and at the same time you run Acorn pumps, the Acorn pump sees a higher suction pressure and that then generates a higher flow across the pump and it runs more efficiently. That running of Acorn pump also increases the demand seen by the Black Hawk or Black Hawk East pumps, and therefore they move further to the right on their pump curve and they run more efficiently. So you actually get a double benefit. You actually are running both pump stations more efficiently and using less kilowatt hours per million gallons delivered. I'll now hand over to Mohammed to talk about the impacts this had on water quality.
Okay, thanks, Simon. So one remaining question was, if we change the optimization scenarios, how does that impact the water quality? So what we did is we first did some offline simulation using hydraulic models, and we used water age as an indicator of the water quality. As you can see, the top figures are basically the maximum water age in the distribution system, and the bottom table shows the average water age in the tanks. So what we observed in this offline simulation is that the water age did not substantially change from the baseline. It was, if you look at the tank turnover, turnover was around 10 to 13%. So it was within the 2-3% of the baseline. So when we went to the real-time operation, we monitored a few water quality parameters. And here is the residual chlorine in the tanks. As you can see for these both tanks, Black Hawk and Acorn, when we were operating the baseline condition, which is pre-optimization condition, and all the optimization condition had a similar chlorine residual. So it allowed us to believe that probably even if you change the optimization condition, the water quality will not be impacted. Although if you run pumps continuously, there is a little bit of indication that water quality might be better if you can run all three pumps at the same time. So, the only limitation of this conclusion is that we ran this study only for 6-8 weeks or so. Probably longer term study is needed to understand whether there is any impact on water quality due to changing optimization scenarios. When we did the same thing for Eastern Municipal Water District, the conclusion was pretty much the same. We did not see any significant or any noticeable change in terms of water quality when we changed from one optimization scenario to another. Now let's talk a little bit about the business case for an EWQMS. First of all, it needs to be aligned with your business goals and operational goals. In a typical energy project, we normally make decisions based on the financial assessments. For an EWQMS type of projects, we need to look at both financial and non-financial costs and benefits associated with EWQMS. This slide shows what are the tangible cost benefit of implementing an EWQMS. When you look at the cost, certainly you need to have the infrastructure that's going to support these EWQMS, SCADA, meters, and telemetry, remote control, all sorts of hardware you need to have. And you certainly need an optimization software. You can build one or you can get a commercial one. And then you need to bring all your assets under that EWQMS. So quite a bit of effort needs to be put in that aspect. And you need to have a training program at the beginning of the project to train everyone involved in this EWQMS implementation. Looking at the operational expenses, if you are using a commercial product, then certainly you will have to incur some licensing fees. Also, you need to have some budget for troubleshooting and maintenance. You need to have some labor-related costs. Typically, when we're talking with all these utilities, they're saying you need to have at least 1 to 2 full-time employees dedicated for the EWQMS project. And of course, you need to have continuous training programs so that people know what they're supposed to do for EWQMS projects. Now, what are the benefits? Of course, the first is the cost savings. We need to account for that. And there might be some opportunities to work with electric utilities. If you participate in their automated demand response program, there might be the opportunity to get some revenue out of that. So that should be an opportunity to discuss with electric utilities. And as we saw that we will have the opportunity to reduce greenhouse gas. Currently, water utilities cannot participate in the cap and trade program in California, but there might be an opportunity in the future where there will be a value for carbon and that greenhouse gas emission reduction might be available for carbon credit. So all these things needs to be included within the lifetime of the project to make a decision based on the tangible cost benefit analysis. Now, looking at the intangible cost benefit analysis, first is the cultural conflict. And your system has been operating manually for all these years. Now it's going to be under automated control. So certainly there will be some concerns or fear. And one of the things that some of the utilities mentioned that there is fear that if you go under automated control, there is a risk of losing that knowledge of running it manually when there is an emergency. So you need to address some of these concerns or issues at the beginning of the project. And as we saw, depending on the optimization, there might be some losers or some winners in terms of water quality. So we'll have to see how water quality changes based on the optimization scenario. The risk associated with the implementation, the system will be tested the way it has never been tested. So there might be some risk during the implementation. These things need to be accounted for when we're talking about intangible risk of EWQMS. There are some benefits, intangible benefits, that will allow you to avoid some of the costs that you may have if you don't have EWQMS. One of the things that came up is the improved asset performance visibility. Now you have more information on how your pumps are operating, so you might be able to make informed decision to improve the life of the pumps. Improved emergency response. You can see the divergence between your SCADA data and the model prediction, and you'll be able to identify if there is any issue in the field, and you can respond to that very quickly. In terms of other benefits, improved strategic and simulations or planning. And now if you have a new tariff, or if you have a population growth, a new demand, or new storage, then you can simulate all these using offline simulator and make plans accordingly. One of the things is the improved uniformity of operation. EWQMS actually allows utilities to remove some of the inconsistencies between the operator ships. Also, treatment plant can be will be smoother. So there are some intangible benefits. One particular point that a lot of utilities mentioned is it allows you to minimize human errors. And when it's operated, controlled by operators, there might be human judgment. So when you have EWQMS, it allows you to minimize some of those errors caused by human judgment. So this all needs to be included when you are developing a true business case for your utility. And now, of course, there are a lot of challenges with EWQMS, and it was a learning process for a lot of these utilities. So, in our report, we identify some of these challenges. We try to understand some of the true causes of these challenges, and we propose to some good recommended practices for these challenges. I'm going to highlight a few of them here. The first one is related to constraints. You know, there is a tendency that at the initial stage of the projects, utilities tend to make list of constraints larger. And what it does is it makes the algorithm complex and the solution takes longer than expected. And sometimes you don't even have the solution if you have too many constraints. There are two different types of constraints. One is physical constraints, which you will have to address. There are also some technical constraints based on the way operator used to operate the system. And we just need to be conscious of the operator's preference and the constraints and make the true constraints into the program. Some of the ways we can minimize the challenge associated with the constraint is to start with the lowest number of constraints first and then build on it. Also, you can make a list of all the constraints and see and prioritize them based on their importance. One aspect of dealing with this is to standardize your operation and change control rules. And if you can and train these operators according to that standardized operating procedure, that will minimize some of these constraints that typically utilities built in their EWQMS system. The second challenge is the override. And if you have manual intervention, if you have too frequent overrides, you're going to reduce the savings you're going to realize. So it is important to minimize overrides as much as possible to maximize the savings from the EWQMS operation. Oftentimes, when optimizers produce solutions is not according to what operator was expecting, they tend to override the system. So it is important to understand the true causes of overrides and minimize those causes. Some of the things can be done is to minimize number of constraints and maybe improve, have a better system to solve the field issues and have a better maintenance policy, maybe have a more training program. One thing can be done is to identify when this overrides happens, identify what caused this overrides and what can be done to avoid this overrides in the future. Should you need to change the software? Should you do more training? Or should you change some of these constraints or rules? Those things need to be discussed within the team. The cultural issues, and this is an important aspect of EWQMS implementation, and some of the things can be done is organize meetings among the IT and operation and management people so they can discuss the integration issues. One aspect came again and again is to have the operators in the discussion table at all stages of the project, and you need to hear what their issues are, what their concerns are, and address those concerns or issues through the implementation of EWQMS. The last item is the training. There is a training requirement. One aspect of training is to allow operators to learn the software and how to use the optimizer. The other aspect of it is learn in a way that they can use it for all different operating conditions. And that will allow them to not only to generate, get the skill they need to use the software solution, but also they will be prepared to use it effectively and generate the maximum benefits from EWQMS implementation. And the training needs to be throughout the, you know, there should be some initial training also throughout the project. Throughout the year, there should be some trainings among the all parties involved in this project. So let's, in terms of conclusion, what we learned from this project is that the cost optimization can reduce costs. At the same time, it can also reduce energy consumption, also reduce greenhouse gas emission substantially. So just by implementing some of these fundamental energy efficiency practices in your cost optimization, you can do both. You can do cost optimization as well as greenhouse gas emission reduction. Now we know that EWQMS can be implemented for kilowatt hour optimization as well as for greenhouse gas optimization. So now we have options depending on the utility, depending on the tariff, depending on the situation. Utility have the option to decide whether cost optimization should be the choice, or they should go after kilowatt hour or greenhouse gas optimization. But there may be some trade-offs between these optimization scenarios, so that needs to be properly evaluated. We try to start an interesting discussion about this variability of greenhouse gas emission factors during the daytime. This is just one project. I think there will be more projects, more studies needs to be done to establish a accepted way of addressing this. Until then, I think utilities should be just focusing on kilowatt hour optimization if their goal is to reduce greenhouse gas of the operation. And the last point is, the most important point is to have a successful implementation of EWQMS. It's a complex process and it requires commitment from all levels of the organization. And that's when you can have the maximum benefit of the EWQMS implementation. With that, I thank everyone for your time and paying attention to our work. The final report is available on the Water Research Foundation website, and you can contact Linda Ricci for if you need information on how to access the final report. With that, Linda, I'll hand it back to you.
Thanks so much, Mohammed, and thanks, Simon. You both made a complex topic rather easy to understand, I think, so I appreciate that. You've mentioned a lot of benefits of EQAMS, and I have a question. Why do you think more utilities have not implemented the EWQMS?
I'll answer this, if you don't mind, Mohammed. It's a question we get asked a lot, and it's a question that comes up all around the world. And I think we know that the water utility industry is very conservative, and quite rightly so. Water delivery is the key driver for the operators, delivering water at acceptable quality and acceptable pressure to the customers, and that is the major driver. Handing over to an EWQMS system means handing over, as Mohammed said, to an automatic system, something that will actually control the distribution, and that has a lot of concerns, raises a lot of concerns. I think, though, as more systems are installed and employed around the world, that fear will abate, and then people will eventually will become like when SCADA systems were first implemented. A few early adopters, a lot of industry watching, and then very gradually, everyone rolled out a SCADA system. I think EWQMS systems and other smart technology systems will eventually become a norm in the water industry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I wanted to add one more point to that is there might be an opportunity to actually design these optimizers for some of the mid-size or small-size utilities. I'm sure in the future there will be solutions that are suitable for the mid-size and small size utilities. Once we have that, these implementation will probably be even more.
So it sounds like there might be a certain size water system for which an EWQMS is optimal then. Is that true?
Right now, these are all large utilities. Their energy bills are high, so they can have a very attractive payback period.
Mm-hmm. When you implemented these EWQMS at particularly the pilot utilities, did you detect any interest by the electric utility that was serving the water utility during this project?
Again, I'm happy to answer that one. The electricity utilities, certainly in California, are very proactive, and they have incentive programs in place for energy efficiency projects and for demand response projects. And those incentive programs can actually fund a lot of these sort of EWQMS implementations. I also think that as they get to work with the water utilities, I think it's a little bit of a surprise to the electricity industry just how much electrical load a water utility can move from peak to off-peak and just how flexible they can be in operations. So if you're thinking of a normal water utility maybe running, you know, at least, you know, 15, 20 megawatts of pumping at a reasonable size utility, they can turn that pumping on and off really at a moment's notice in a lot of applications, as long as they have storage in the zones to provide customers with water. And if the electricity companies have short-term demand problems in an area, being able to call on a water utility to drop 4 or 5 megawatts for maybe an hour or two is hugely beneficial to the electricity company and therefore can be hugely beneficial for the water utility in terms of payments. The key then, of course, is making sure that those decisions are safe, that the customers will not actually run out of water, and that, that there is no real implications in terms of water quality or performance of the network. And the EWQMS system can make that happen. So what we are seeing is that the energy companies are now getting a better understanding, and they are offering better incentive programs in terms of demand response and tariffs to the water utilities. In fact, that super off-peak tariff that we showed at EMWD is a Southern California Edison incentive, because they know that EMWD can avoid that very peak stress period of their time, and they really incentivize them to do it.
That's interesting. Thank you. Here's a comment from the audience. Thanks for the great presentation. How does the water quality objective function look like, or what does the water quality objective function look like, and what exactly was the optimization target?
Go ahead. Effectively, there is no specific optimization for water quality inside the optimization of EWQMS, and the reason for that is manifold. First of all, water quality is a many-day optimization requirement, so you're looking typically at 5 or even 10 days of continuous optimization strategy to make sure that water age, which is a proxy for water quality, is not impacted by the EWQMS. The second thing is that there is actually very little feedback as to what is actually the residual chlorine at various points in the system, so there isn't actually a lot of data points to come back that would allow an optimization strategy to take into account changes in water quality. So what happens in EWQMS is, in fact, it uses a proxy for water quality, which is water age, and it does that by trying to make sure that tanks turn over so that water in storage tanks is under 5 days of age. And in general, most water utilities will tell you that if you keep the water age below 5 days to the customer, residual chlorine is usually acceptable at the point of the tap. But hopefully that answers your question.
That sounds good. Thank you. And then another question, how long does it typically take to design and implement an EWQMS at a water utility?
Well, this varies from one utility to another. It depends on the complexity of the system. When we are talking with these case study utilities, they took 6 months to 2 years actually to implement it. So it's a it's a process that they had to go through. They implement in certain area, they learn from it, and then expand it. So there is no specific timeline, but anywhere from 6 months to a couple of years, depending on the utility and the complexity of their system. Unless Simon wants to add something to that.
I think I certainly agree with you, Mohammed. And one of the key things is, again, that this is a major change for all the utility, and then making sure that cultural change occurs right across the organization means there's no rush. It is much more important to get it right than to get it in quickly. And I think the audience would agree with that you want to actually go through stage by stage, training, getting everyone to understand, because this is going to impact operations, planning, engineering. You know, every department in the water utility is somehow going to be affected by running an EWQMS system, and they need to understand why it's been done, what the benefits are, how it's going to impact their job, and so on. And to cover off all the issues that the audience is raising on things like water quality and what impacts this might have on maintenance or pump starting and stopping and so on.
All right. Well, again, I want to thank you both, Mohammed and Simon, for a great presentation. We are at the top of the hour, and so I would just like to urge our audience to please participate in the short survey that is going to pop up on your screen momentarily. Thanks for joining in today. Take care.